There we go.
Well, good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon.
What a pleasure to be here. I had no idea where I was coming. This is great. I am Dr. Robert Carter. I am a speaker for Creation Ministries International out of our offices near Atlanta. I happen to be a scientist, but the most important part of my life is that I'm a follower of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I was, as you've now heard, a marine biologist. I spent my time studying the coral reefs in Florida. I had about 700 scuba dives. It was a great life for a long time. But eventually I had to get serious, and I ended up in the genetics lab. And the university awarded me my degree when I managed to steal the genes for those bright green and bright red colors and engineer them into these fish. So my background is in genetic engineering as aspects of marine biology. So in other words, I know this much about this much. And that's what being a scientist is. You have to focus until no one in the world can tell you you're wrong. And that's when you get your degree. And therefore, I joined a giant fraternity. They hazed me for 8 years. And what happens when I say, oh, by the way, guys, I don't believe that evolution stuff. I'll never work at university again. But it was worth it to be able to come here and share some of these things with you. But you see, as a young scientist, I needed a guide. I needed to know, how do I approach this crazy world and all this technology and stuff that may or may not be moral? What do we do? Well, I found it right here in Genesis chapter 1. It says, and God blessed them, as Adam and Eve. And God said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over every living thing that moves on the earth. So the Bible says that people were put on earth as stewards, as caretakers of God's creation. That is our role. But in order to take care of something, you have to understand that something, right? The pursuit of understanding is called science. So the reason for science is to glorify God and fulfill our role as people on earth. Did you know the Bible gave a guide to science in the first chapter of the Bible? It's right there, just for us. CMI, we've been writing about how science and the Bible work together for nearly 40 years now in our Creation magazine. And just as a little aside, you're going to see little pictures of Creation magazines popping up through my talk. That's just to show you how much of this information I got from reading this magazine since I started subscribing in 1990. I'm actually a second generation CMI scientist, and the people who founded this organization, which is, I think there are 33 speakers based out of 7 different countries. They're retiring. And so now the young Turks are coming in and trying to fill some very big shoes. So Creation Magazine has been a tremendous blessing to me for many, many years. But we do a lot more than just our magazine. We also have a gigantic website called creation.com. I can almost guarantee you that if you have a question, your question's answered on our website. How do I know that? Because we have 9,000 articles on our website. So what are you thinking about, you know, how do you work this out? What's the answer to that? Go to our website, click around a little bit. Go to the question and answer section, or type in something in a search box, and articles will come up. And if an article doesn't come up, you send us an email, and we answer every email we get, even the ones that use four-letter language. And that's about a third of them. It is amazing how emotional people get on this topic. But let me give an example, though, of this of some of the things we do. We do a lot with a cultural worldview battle that's happening in the Western world right now. Here's my first example. How many of you have heard of Billy Graham? All right, great. How many of you have heard of Charles Templeton? That's funny, because Charles Templeton was the famous guy in the 50s. Billy Graham was the other guy. That's Charles Templeton preaching to a stadium full of people. Do you know what I would give to preach to a stadium full of people? And yet before the man died, he writes his book, Farewell to God, My Reasons for Rejecting Christian Faith. He died an atheist. And he claims in his book that there are a lot of unanswered questions in Christianity. Now follow this list of questions. This is just a couple of them that he raised. And see if you wonder about these same things. Explain the age of the universe. What about ape men? Where did the floodwaters come from? Where did they go when the flood was over? Why do bad things happen in this world if a good God created the world? Those are big questions. Have you ever wondered about those questions? Do you know any people who struggle with those questions yourself or use the lack of answers to those questions is a reason to reject Christianity? Yeah. You know what's terrifying? I had the same list of questions when I was 18 years old. And most of my friends who had those questions aren't working with God today. Walking with God today. This whole creation evolution thing is a huge reason for people falling away from the faith. But you know, we've got more information on this topic than any other time in church history. We should be shouting, the Bible's history! And yet most people in America have never heard anyone defend the Bible. How do I know that? I went to church all my life. The only reason I ever heard someone defend the Bible was because I liked this girl and I went over to her house for dinner and her mom witnessed to me. That was the first time I heard the gospel, even though I was a church-going, good young man. Good. I don't want to talk about the things I did when my parents weren't looking. I was as lost as I could be. And basically, right now, I'm a statistic that shouldn't exist. Because the further up in the echelons of science you go, the more likely you are to be an atheist. Now, there's a question, though. Does science produce atheists, or does the scientific establishment weed out other people? That's two very different questions, isn't it? And the answer is science does not produce atheists. In fact, it's really funny if you look at 18, 19, 20-year-olds. This is the great falling away period. This is when, if you're going to lose your faith, that's when it's going to happen. People who go to college are less likely to lose their faith than those who don't. So it's not college that does. It's not education. It's not training. It's the culture. And man, I tell you what, you people with gray hair, yeah, I'm getting there too, but you people with gray hair, you grew up in a very different world than your kids and grandkids are growing up in. Man, back in the 50s, if you said, I'm an atheist, you would be a social pariah. Today, I saw, I don't know if you know Ricky Gervais, he's a comedian. I don't like this guy. But the reason, there's a lot of, you know, unsaved comedians who are funny. But this guy, I watched a YouTube video of him. He's given his thing, and he goes, now we're going to open the Bible. And he opens the Bible, and all he did was read Genesis chapters 1, 2, and 3. With no comments, he just read it. And the audience was dying laughing the whole time. Welcome to America. Oh, boy. So when we look at the statistics, here's four different surveys, slightly different questions, slightly different groups, but this is the percent of kids growing up in church that will leave and not come back. You know what that 88% is from? That's from the Southern Baptist Sunday School Board. These are kids who are baptized, who go to youth group, who go on youth retreats, maybe mission trips. These are kids who are active in church. And what's the average there? Two-thirds? And guess what questions they're using as they're walking away? Oh, science tells us that people evolved from apes 6 million years ago, Adam and Eve. That's nonsense. Those sorts of questions. This whole evolution thing, it's a great, tremendous stumbling stone. Now look, I'm not going to make the mistake of thinking everyone here believes like I do. That'd be silly. I used to not believe like I do. But my point here is not to tell you you're wrong. My point here is to challenge you. And so I'm going to continue to throw out as many challenges as I can, the same way that I was challenged when I was younger, to unthink some of the things that I thought were true. But it's a stepwise process. We got to get through it. But my whole goal here in challenging these issues on origins, where we came from, how old things are, is to see if the Bible really is the Word of God. And it's in challenging people, I found, I mean, just as an aside, just last week I had locked my keys. I lost my keys for my car. And it's a 13-year-old car, and it's the last set of keys I had. And so I had to call a locksmith. I was like, oh, I'm so embarrassed. And it cost a lot of money, too. It was really annoying. But I had to call a locksmith to get me into my car and give me a new key. And so the guy's got a weird accent. I said, hey, man, where are you from? He goes, I'm from Israel. I said, oh, you're Jewish? He kind of looked like this. He's like, well, you're not Palestinian. You would have said Palestine. He goes, no, I'm Jewish culturally, but I'm an atheist. I don't believe in God. I said, why not? He used one word. Guess what that word was? He said, science. Oh, yes. I said, boom, let's go, man. No. I said, oh, really? I said, well, what do you mean science? What kind of science? Well, give me something. He goes, carbon dating. Answered it. I'll address that in about 20 minutes, half an hour maybe. He said, ape men. I said, which one? So you want to talk about Neanderthal? Because because we can now sequence Neanderthal DNA. Neanderthals are people.
Amen.
Oh, whoops. All the stuff they said 100 years ago, totally wrong. And all the, just a couple examples. Really, when people want to make an objection, there's only four or five common ones they bring up all the time. It's not that hard to have at least an answer, or hey, even if you don't know the answer, hey man, go to creation.com and read an article about it, and I'm going to come back to you tomorrow and I'm going to ask you if you read that article. That's a challenge and a half right there. You don't have to know it. You just got to point them in that direction. Anyway, if you would like some help in this, we have a newsletter we send out once a week. It's full of, you know, exciting stuff, personal testimonies, new, like our Evolution of Achilles Heels trailer. It's things that are designed to help you answer your own questions. Because we found out that people who have their own questions answered are much more likely to talk about their faith. Because if you don't, if you've got some glaring questions in your head, you're scared. And intimidation happens to me all the time. Not all the time. It has happened to me many times in my life where I wasn't, so I didn't say anything. I know the Spirit's prompted me to say something, and I didn't. Ooh, that's not good. So let us equip ourselves. And as I'm speaking, my friend Harrison here, who, by the way, he's an engineer. I just met him a couple of weeks ago. And he came to one of my events to volunteer. And I found out he's going to be up here, so he showed up here too. This is, hardly know the guy. He's awesome. Anyway, this is what our sign-up form looks like. Just put your contact details down. If you don't want it, no big deal. Just pass the person next to you. No problem. But when they're done, can you make sure they like accumulate on the ends of the things here so we can pick them up afterwards? I'd appreciate it. All right. Those are going around, and we're talking about science. But when I use that word, most people don't know what I'm talking about. There's several, and the reason for that is there are different forms of science. One type is called operational science. It deals with observing and repeating things today. And that type of science has led to development of all of our modern technology, including this nuclear-powered rover that NASA's driving around on Mars. Amazing technology. Have you ever struggled in science class?
Yeah.
Yeah, remember all those awful formulas with all those symbols in there? You know most of those symbols are the initials of a Christian's name? Because operational science is pioneered by Christians, like men like Johann Kepler. He discovered the three laws of planetary motion that NASA used to get that rover to Mars. And he said of his work, it was like thinking God's thoughts after him. But if you made a list of early modern scientists, almost every one of them would be called a Bible believer. Now, they had different range of viewpoints on different issues, but almost all of them would say, yeah, I believe the Bible. What is happening here? Well, the answer is that science and Christianity are not at odds with one another.
Amen.
In fact, Christianity gave birth to modern science. Yeah. Why? Because science is a logical thinking process, right? So is biblical Christianity. You're commanded to study. Amen. You're commanded to work things out and to think. Amen. You read the New Testament, anything written by the Apostle Paul, and, but, or, therefore, those are logical statements. All this stuff follows, therefore we can make a conclusion. It's a thinking person's religion, but we start with faith.
Yeah.
But it doesn't mean we turn our brains off when we walk in the church door.
Right.
But take that, now apply it to theology. What does the Bible say about God? He's omnipotent. He's omniscient. He's all-powerful. Oh, I just said that.
Omnipresent.
He's omnipresent. And he's not fickle.
That's right.
He didn't change his mind on a whim. The ultimate lawgiver, would he not make a universe that fits his own character and nature? Yeah, and that thought right there is what led to the development or the discovery of scientific law. Christian philosophy. Did you know that? Of course not. The world doesn't want you to know that. But what I just told you, I actually learned from secular historians. They know it. They just don't promote it much. So why is it then, though, that so many scientists are not Christians? Well, because there's more than one form of science. Here's another form. It's called historical science. But historical science is trying to look back into the past and figure out what happened. That's not the same thing as today figuring out how things work, right? They're a little bit different. But think about history. Is history repeatable? Nope. Is history observable? Nope. I don't have a time machine. Is it testable? No, you can't go back in time and shoot Hitler and then go back in time and not shoot Hitler. You can't do that. It's not the same thing as operational science. But this whole evolution creation debate, that's the debate. We're not arguing over the boiling point of water. We're arguing over, was Neanderthal a dead-end branch of humanity or people? Now, sometimes we can answer those questions using modern science. Sometimes we can't. But the fact that both sides make specific claims, and a lot of those claims overlap, means that this fight is not going to win. But usually, when people are arguing, going in circles, you ever get those frustrating going in circles questions? A lot of times, in conversation, get the fact that they're actually arguing over things that both of them. Fossils exist, right? You can measure them, right? You can x-ray them, you can smell them, you could dissolve them in acid, right? A fossil is a fact, correct? Mm-hmm. Is the history of the fossil... have it now, do I know how it got here? Not necessarily. See, there's a difference there. Operational versus historical science. So, science class. You're now being tested. Look at that display there. Museum. They have a dead dinosaur and he gets buried and petrified over millions of years. You know, plate tectonics happens, a mountain forms, and now there's a dead dinosaur sticking out of the side of a hill. True or false? How do you know? What kind of science is this? It's historical science. It's not operational. But see, there's a problem here. I am subject to this. Because we're people. And the problem is this. That kind of does make sense, right? And it sticks in our head as being true. Even if it's not. And so when we're talking to people about salvation and faith and God, they've got all these things in their head that they assume are true. They don't fall over like that. Amen. Man, God has to whack them upside the head really hard to shake those things around. You're not going to do it. However, you can often be used to knock one or two of those things down, and sometimes it's the final one. And that's when we see someone come to Christ.
Amen.
Okay, boy, wow. We can test that, though. We can test using operational science. How would you do it? Well, what if we got in a submarine and looked around the oceans for a big dead thing? What do you think you're going to see? Well, there's a dead whale. Ugh. Yeah, that museum display was absolutely 100% wrong. It was scientifically invalid and erroneous, and they probably knew it when they put it up. Because things in the bottom of the ocean get eaten. In fact, according to the laws of chemistry, bones dissolve in seawater. So how do you get something like this? Was that fish petrified before he rotted? Yes. How do you get something like this? How do you get something like that? Was Mama Ichthyosaur living on the bottom of some warm Mesozoic sea for millions of years as she slowly buried and petrified? Exactly. In fact, do you see the baby? I said Mama Ichthyosaur. It's a baby. In fact, in my mind, she was buried so fast that the pressure is what expelled the fetus. Because a baby wouldn't be half born, that much born, and then floating around in the waters and Mama sank. It's not going to happen. In fact, this last summer they found another ichthyosaur. She's got a baby in her stomach, one half born and one right next to her. That's cool, but look at this one. That is a salamander. Do you see the gills up here on the left? Do you see the tail? Tail's only a few cells thick. So first question, how do you turn that to stone? Second question, how long does it take? Does it take millions of years? Not that fossil. No way. But millions of years, geology doesn't really have a handle on stuff like this. They got a problem. So let me introduce you to another historical model. This is this is my model of how fossils form. History. That's a fish.
Nemo.
call him Nemo or Goldie, whatever you want to call him. Give him some fancy name. And now bury him in an underwater avalanche caused by Noah's flood. And well, poor guy, now he's dead. But he's buried in mud. And as the mud dries out, any salts or minerals in the water are going to crystallize. And if we do that quick enough, we can replace parts of his body. We call that a fossil. It must occur quickly or it's not going to happen. We have a documentary on the tables over here called Evolution's Achilles Heel. I'm very proud of this. This is 3 years of my life. We've now won 2 different awards at Christian film festivals. I'm really happy the way it came out and the reception that we've gotten. But all we interviewed were PhD scientists. It happens to be Bible-believing PhD scientists, but it's all we interviewed was PhD scientists. So we said, okay, Mr. Nerdy Scientist, tell us, in according to your area of expertise, what can evolution not answer? I'll relax. I'm hearing a wee. Okay. Absolutely. In fact, chapter 4 is the origin of life, which flies in the face of everything we know about chemistry and physics and probability and information theory. There's nothing in science and operational science that suggests that the origin of life is even remotely possible. You got it. Here we have Dr. Marcus Ross. He's a paleontologist, so he's a fossil expert. And he said, the existence of a fossil is actually proof that something happened very, very fast. But then he says this. He says, but if the fossil happened fast, the rocks that contain the fossil must also have occurred quickly. And now we're talking about the fossil record. Each layer must have occurred quickly. Now the question, how much time is in between them? That's the next question. But the layers themselves must have occurred quickly, or you wouldn't get fossils like that. But look at this thing. That's a tree. That's a man standing next to a tree. Now, how long does trees stick up out of the forest after they die? Have you ever heard count up the layers, count up the years? Yeah. What is that? Hundreds of thousands of years of evolutionary history? That tree is defying evolutionary time. And there are thousands of examples of what are called polystrate, many layered fossils that stick vertically through the fossil record and say, no, evolution is not possible because the time is not possible. That's one of many, many examples we could do. Notice what I'm doing with these examples. All the ones I did on purpose. I'm trying to get you to question time. Because that is critical. Evolution is all about time. Given evolutionists millions of years, they can work miracles. But what if that time actually didn't exist? Where does the millions of years idea come from? Well, actually it comes from logic. I don't agree with it, but watch this. Look at Grand Canyon. Look how big it is. Look how slow erosion it is. Therefore, it took millions of years to carve Grand Canyon. Wait. Is it true? No, but that's the assumption that's true. Notice that's a historical question, isn't it? It's history we're dealing with here. But what if something happened in between that sped up the rate of erosion? Or what if when we look at erosion of rivers today, it doesn't really match the shape of the canyon? That's true. What if slow and gradual actually doesn't explain this? Where do we go? What could possibly explain it? I'm getting there. But first, a little anecdote about myself. That's me. 12 years old. Socks pulled up to my knees. Oh, man, I love that style. It's tube socks. They don't sell them anymore, do they? Those double red stripes. Awesome. I was living in a beach town in New York State. And I remember May of that year, all these beautiful red sunrises. The sun was coming up over the ocean, red, like, what is this? Well, what happened was something happened 3,000 miles away from my house. Mount St. Helens exploded, and it affected the weather in New York. And my little scientific mind was going, click, 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 what is on earth is happening? And well, Mount St. Helens has given us a tremendous testimony that a lot of geology can happen in a short amount of time. This is actually 3 different layers laid down by the volcano. That lower layer was formed, this is miles away from the volcano, basically, boom, splat. And then a month later, a boiling hot cloud of steam and ash came racing down the mountain and deposited that middle layer. And then 2 years later, a mud flow came. came racing down the mountain, deposited the upper layer, and carved that canyon. Oh, and if we zoom up on that middle layer, we see all these finely layered sediments that any geologist before this would have said, count up the layers, count up the years, slow and gradual, millions of years. But we saw this form in an afternoon. So when we go to other places in the fossil record, I say, wait a minute, this looks just like Mount St. Helens. Why does this have to be millions of years? So we can actually undo a lot of evolutionary extrapolations because this is operational science. This is documented. We were alive. A lot of us were alive when this happened. It's not history. But how old is the Earth? How do we know? It's a historical question. That's right. How do we know? Well, let's look at the Bible here. We have a Bible, right? We're in church. We can talk about the Bible. The Bible claims to be the history book of the universe. Like it or not, it does. So we got to deal with this. And in that history, the Bible starts off with a very straightforward account of God creating the universe in 6 days, just a little more than 6,000 years ago. Does that embarrass you? It did me. I was terrified of this. I tried everything I could think of to make that millions of years. So, oh, maybe each of the days of Genesis was really a long period of time. That worked until someone pointed out that that means that God would have created the sun millions of years after it created plants. Well, maybe God used evolution to do all the creating. No, because whales supposedly evolved from land animals and whales appeared earlier than land animals. There's no evolutionary order to this. And I tried and tried and tried because I knew what was going to happen if I believed this. It happened eventually, but I didn't want it to. But one of the things that drove me here was the way the New Testament treats this. You must understand there are more than 100 references to Genesis in the New Testament. And 60 of those come from the first 11 chapters. What's in the first 11 chapters of the Bible? That's Adam and Eve, Noah's flood, and the Tower of Babel. And every single New Testament author refers to them. Jesus himself at least 16 times in the Gospels, including his famous discourse on marriage and divorce, where he says, "But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female." That's a direct quote from Genesis chapter 1. "Therefore, man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh." Straight out of Genesis chapter 2. Have you ever heard there's more than one creation account in Genesis? Yeah, well, Jesus is quoted from both of them in the same breath. Obviously, he doesn't think they're two different accounts. But did he really believe that Adam existed at the beginning of creation? That he didn't believe in the Big Bang? He's referring here to the creation account of Genesis. And when I realized that Jesus was saying stuff like this, I'd take a step back. Because what are the alternatives? Mark lied? Jesus never said that? Bible's not the Word of God. Or Jesus didn't know that evolution was true? Jesus isn't God. Or Jesus knew evolution was true and he lied. He said creation is true? That makes him not the God I want to serve. So which cliff do you want to fall off of here? And that's the problem there. I mean, there are tons of these just in the New Testament. You can't just say, oh, that one, because then another one pops up, and then another one, and another one. But I understand most people don't accept this as history. I got that. I used to not. Probably someone here who doesn't. That's cool. We're working on this. But there's a danger in that. Look what Jesus told Nicodemus in John chapter 3. You all know John 3, right? All right, John 3:16, Nicodemus says, "Can a man be born again?" And Jesus said, "If I've told you earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you heavenly things?" Well, I believe one of the main reasons why Christianity struggles to remain relevant in American culture, Western cultures, is because the earthly science and the earthly history in the Bible are looked at as being nonsense. Therefore, when those same authors wrote spiritual things, well, since they either lied or made up the other stuff, you know what? They must have made up that spiritual stuff too. And the baby gets thrown out with the bathwater. We see that often. But the Bible is consistent in its treatment of Genesis as a foundational document. Look what Paul says in Romans 5. "Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man." What man is that? "And death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sinned." Does that mean there's no death before Adam? If evolution is true, Adam's father would have been Homo sapiens. He died. See, evolution requires millions of years of death to produce people from monkeys. The Bible says that death came after the fact. We get this idea from Genesis chapter 2. The Lord God commanded the man, saying, "You may surely eat of the every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for the day that you eat of it you shall surely die." But Adam did it, right? So death came into the world because of the rebellion of man. Which, by the way, that's why Jesus had to die. He was God, right? Couldn't he said, "Hey, y'all, your sins are forgiven. Have a nice day," and gone back up to heaven? Well, he could have. Except God said the punishment for sin is death. And he wouldn't accept our death to pay for our own sins, because you need an unblemished lamb. Which is why he had to be a man, and why he had to be sinless. Oh, man. But Adam did it. He reached out. He took the fruit. And because of that, God said, "Cursed is the ground because of you. In pain you shall eat of it all the days of your life." But it's not the dirt. It's the universe. Look at Romans 8. Paul says things like, "For the creation waits with eager longing. For the creation was subject to futility, in hope that creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption. The whole creation has been groaning together in pains of childbirth until now." He keeps harping on the fact that the entire universe is weighed down by the weight of Adam's sin. And it affects all of us today. Which gives me another opportunity to talk about myself. That's my sawmill there. It's my son posing on my sawmill. I own a sawmill. I love working with wood. That's a picture of my living room floor, actually. That's 5-inch wide quarter sawn red oak I took from a 90-foot tree. Took me 2 years to make my floor. It's a hobby. It's good exercise. It's fun, but it's dangerous. Because to feed a sawmill, you have to run a chainsaw. I call this tree Rob's Right Legs Memorial Stump. Because 3 years ago, I had just cut this tree down, and I was cutting that stump. If you ever run a chainsaw, you realize I did something very dumb. I didn't know it until I did it. And the chain went, pow! Oh, that's what shin bones look like. You see the scar? Oh, if my wife wasn't home, I'd be dead. I don't know why I'm alive right now. I'm sure you've all got stories, things like that, right? But you know what? If you're a Christian, the reason you're alive is because God's got it. He's got a reason for you to be alive. You're part of the kingdom. But what happens when our purpose in God's eyes is fulfilled? We're going to die. Now, I like to tell non-Christians that if you're not a Christian, I suspect there's people in here that are praying for you, that one day you'll bow your knee and say, "Thank you, Lord. You didn't have to do that. I shouldn't be here." We only exist at the mercy of our God. But look at the promises that are waiting for his children. It's Revelation 21, towards the end of the Bible. "He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, or crying, or pain anymore, for the former things are passed away." What are the former things? It's all the junk we got from Adam. And why do I say that? Because in the very next chapter, it says there is no more curse. Oh. And then the tree of life reappears. Revelation is fixing the problem set up in the first book of the Bible. They're like two bookends on a very consistent story. You know what that is? That black squiggly line there? Those are all the chapters in the Bible. That rainbow, those are all the cross references amongst all the chapters in the Bible. You can't pull Genesis out of that without destroying the integrity of the rest of Scripture. And I've tried many times. But if Genesis is really history, then the earth is not millions of years old. How do we fit things like the fossil record into that short amount of time? Or remember the Mount St. Helens example? Where a lot of geology happened in that little area in a short time under the right conditions? What if something worldwide happened? Of course, now we're talking about Noah's flood. About 1,600 years after that scene in the garden, we got a man named Noah. And Genesis 6 says, "And God said to Noah, the end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through them, and behold, I will destroy them with the earth." So God told Noah to build a large ship. We call it an ark. And in the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, the 17th day of the month, on that day, okay, I know not all of you are scientists. God bless you if you're like an English major. I have no clue how that works. If I hadn't gotten married to my wife, I never would have graduated. She taught me how to spell and how to put
periods and commas and things. I can do it now, but when I was 30 years old, I couldn't do it. Whew. God bless her. Anyway, so you people who actually know grammar and stuff like that, tell me, what genre is this? Is that poetry? Prophecy? Allegory? Historical narrative? Oh yeah, when you run into sentence structure like that and grammatical usage like this, you're in Kings and Chronicles. You're not in Psalms, you're not in Ezekiel. This is written like history. And on that day, all the fountains of the great deep burst forth, and the windows of heaven were opened, and rain fell upon the earth 40 days and 40 nights. Oh, that's nice, but it didn't really happen. If it really happened, what would you expect the result to be? That's a great question, because the church got that wrong in the 1800s. There, Noah's flood pushed around some sandbars on the top, leaving the whole fossil record to be explained by some other causes. And then when the ice ages were discovered, all the evidence for Noah's flood, ice age. And the Bible was removed as an explanation in geology. So this is an important question. What would we expect to see? Well, I'll tell you what. Everywhere I go now, I'm looking for evidence of Noah's flood. And if we train ourselves to look for it, we can see it. But we need to get a couple things in our heads. First of all, think about what rapidly rising muddy water would leave behind. And if we're flooding continents, think of the scale of the deposits. There are layers in Grand Canyon that appear in Georgia, where I live, and Canada, and Maine. The same layer. We're talking about continental scale deposition. It's exactly what we predict. But think about what the waters are going to do when they start leaving the continents. We're not talking about rivers. We're talking about sheets of water over massive areas. About 60% of the continent of Africa is one erosional plain. So all these layers of all these different ages are coming up, and they're all cut off at the same level. What did that? Nothing in the world today. And then we have these weird landforms that are left behind. You've seen Monument Valley and, like, you know, cowboy movies and stuff like that. But you know what? Modern erosion is destroying those things. Nothing today is creating vertical cliffs. Everything's being rounded off. So what in the past created the vertical cliffs? I suspect that this is Noah's flood. The big reason, see all those buttes and mesas have the same height? And these rocks, if you go north to those other rocks on the horizon, these rocks go underneath other rocks. There's about a mile of missing rocks. Something erased the earth down a mile to a flat plain. And then I think as the floodwaters started to peter out, they left some weird things behind that aren't explained by modern erosion. Now go back to Grand Canyon again. You see all the layers? Stage one of the flood. Do you see the erosion? Do you see the erosion between the layers? They're like pancakes stacked on top of each other, aren't they? You realize most of the time the fossil record is in those gaps, right? Almost all the time is in between the layers. And when you look between the layers, there's no evidence of time. But I believe this was laid down during Noah's flood. We have to get something in our head about the flood. This is not a kid's story. This is a horror story. This is the wrath of God poured out on wickedness. But you know, in the middle of all this is a beautiful picture, because Noah is a picture of Christ. Through faith in God, Noah survived the wrath of God. How are we going to survive when Christ returns? Through faith, right? What a beautiful picture. So there's a salvation message in the flood story. But there's some other things about Noah's Ark we got to get our heads wrapped around. First of all, it's huge. If you took that boat and carved it up and put it onto railroad stock cars, your train would be more than 5 miles long. There's plenty of room for two of every kind of animal. At most, a few thousand pairs. I'm thinking probably just a few hundred pairs, and that includes all the extinct animals also. Plus the food and water they need for an entire year. But something else amazing about Noah's Ark, this article that appeared in our Journal of Creation way back in 1994 by some naval architects. They said, that's amazing. The length to width to height ratio of Noah's Ark is optimal for stability. If any of those parameters changed, the ark would have rocked more. When they build ships today of those proportions, they're the most stable ships on the ocean. How did Noah know how to build that? Yeah, and God invented physics. That formula was discovered by naval engineers accidentally in the 1800s. The fact that it appears there in Scripture is an amazing testimony to the scientific and historical accuracy of the book of Genesis. For instance, the Babylonian flood story that people say was the progenitor of the Genesis flood story, their ark was a cube. That's the absolute stupidest shape for an ocean-going ship. Period. They have the corruption. Because if you were just going to monkey with those numbers, you wouldn't actually nail it to that degree of accuracy. Now, I've given you a lot of examples of beautifully preserved animals. I think they're wonderfully consistent with the flood. But here's one more. And evolutionists rarely talk about cases like this jellyfish because it hasn't changed in half a billion years. They say it's 505 millions of years ago. This thing was swimming in the middle of some Cambrian ocean. But he's still alive today. So think about it. Throughout the entire evolutionary history of multicellular life on Earth, with that supposed meteor that killed off the dinosaurs, and the end of the Permian when 99% of all species went extinct, and the time when the oceans went anaerobic, and all these things are happening, this guy's remained unchanged. I thought Darwin taught us things had to change. But on the other hand, one of his cousins turned into things like, panda bears and bumblebees. So on the one hand, you got radical change, on the other hand, you have no change. You know what that means? If evolution can explain both of those, evolution is not science, it's philosophy. And that's what it is. It's a philosophy of history. You can't test it, because it can explain anything. That's really frustrating as a scientist, to have been trained in that thought process, knowing that it actually went nowhere. Now, there's a revolution right now occurring in the field of paleontology. That right there is material that came out of a Tyrannosaurus rex leg bone. That's not fossilized. It still smelled. It was rotting. Now, I can't leave a ham sandwich on a counter for a week before it starts turning green. Could I bury it in my backyard for 65 million years and expect to find my ham sandwich again? No way. So I think this thing was buried in Noah's flood 4,500 years ago. And I'm having a really hard time believing there's any material left that hasn't rotten. Now, if I'm incredulous, how can the evolutionists possibly believe that this thing is 70 million years old? See the problem? We can test evolution with operational science. Operational science of rotting. People have been studying things rotting for a long time. We know how fast things rot. That's not possible to be that old. The same laboratory had this paper just a couple years ago. Those are pictures of cells from inside a dinosaur bone. And they stained them for stains that stain DNA. In fact, I told you a little while ago, we have Neanderthal DNA. Well, that's dinosaur DNA at a higher quality than we pull out of Neanderthals. And yet it's 10 times, 100 times older. Or it's not. And we got to be careful about science, because science is fickle. It'll change on you. And so many people have had their faith destroyed on rocks that turn out to be mythical. And the evolutionists have to go back and fix the damage they've done. They just keep rolling. So that top picture, the charcoal picture, that's a picture of a Neanderthal man. No, it's not. They deliberately distorted it to make it look more like a monkey. That museum, that skeleton, that was in the Museum of Natural History in New York. Why are both of his knees bent? Because it makes his hands hang down lower, makes him look more like a monkey. They're trying to cover up the fact that from the hips down, it looks just like you. Oh. That's those two skulls there? Which one has a bigger brain? Neanderthal? Bigger muscles, stronger bones, thicker tooth enamel. They painted in caves. They made musical instruments out of deer antler. They searched the landscape for rare minerals to grind them up for cosmetics. They bury their dead with their heads pointing toward the sunrise. This is nothing. Nothing you heard about Neanderthal when you're growing up is true. All of it's been thrown out. And one of the reasons for that is genetics. You ever see a science show where they take a skull and they put clay and hair and eyes on it? That's what a person really look like. That's really cool, right? That's what a Neanderthal child looks like. Does he look like half a monkey to you? No, he looks like a little boy. Why does he got green eyes and freckles? Because now that we can pull DNA out of Neanderthal bones, we realize that some of them carry genes that when similar genes appear in Europeans, like my sisters, they cause green eyes and freckles. In fact, we now have, I think, 6 entire Neanderthal genomes. And we have been shocked. I'm happy as can be. I love the results, but the evolutionary community is like, what do we do with this? Neanderthals were Homo sapiens. In fact, I've had my DNA tested with one of those genealogy companies. I'm 3% Neanderthal. That means Neanderthals are my ancestors. That means that they're people, right? But it also means that 3 out of every 100 of my ancestors was a Neanderthal. That's a lot. So who are these people? Well, they're a group of people that lived on the earth after Noah's flood. They were a small group of people. They were incredibly inbred. I mean, the genetic evidence says that all these people are marrying their sisters, cousins, uncles, and things like that. I mean, really inbred. Scary. And they got overwhelmed by a later group of people who moved into the area who brought farming with them. And the result of the mixture of these two groups of people produced everyone who lives outside of Africa. Now, why do I say that? Because Neanderthals didn't live in Africa. They lived in Eurasia. Oh. Now, I know that evolutionists like Charles Darwin and many after him have tried very, very hard to argue that there are multiple different races. I could actually quote some of the horrible, horrible things Charles Darwin said about non-white people in his book in 1871. It's called The Descent of Man. The most politically incorrect, stomach-churning things you could possibly imagine. But I'll skip that. I just want to use this as an example. See those two adults there? Each one of them is mixed race. They have a white mother and a black father. So they contain all the genes for white people and black people. They had these non-identical twin girls. Look, one of them got 2 color genes from both grandfathers. She's darker than her parents. The other guy, one got both the color genes from the grandmothers. She's European color. She's not albino. My kids are lighter than that at that age. My kid's hair is basically clear. It's like all these people, we lived in Miami. The funniest thing. Because you hear these kids who are cue ball bald. And when their head comes in, your hair comes in, you can't even see it until it's longer than that. And all these women would come up. This Hispanic woman is like, did you shave her head? No, she's Viking. That's what they look like. So, looking at this, it is clear, if we can get black and white twins in one generation, all we need is for God to put in a little teeny bit of genetic information into Adam and Eve, and we can explain the origin of the so-called races, piece of cake, in a couple of thousand years. We don't need deep time. We don't need common ancestry with chimpanzees. We don't even hardly need natural selection. It is clear from the genetic data that there is only one human race. That is not what Darwin wanted to know. He taught exactly the opposite. But you know what's exciting about that? That means that all people we all came from the same population. We came from the Tower of Babel, which means we came from Noah's Ark, which means we all descend from Adam and Eve. And do you know why that's important? Because Jesus Christ is the kinsman redeemer. If you're not a descendant of Adam, you're not under the blood of Christ. That's a big problem in the 1800s after evolutionary theory came. What do you do with all the other people out there? Can they even be saved? Are they animals or are they people? Those debates were happening in polite society. But genetically, boom, they're all done. This means that salvation knows no national boundaries, which is why I feel perfectly free to come here and talk to this group. And if the timing is true, how many generations have there been in human history? Well, 4,500 years since the flood, average generation time of 30 years, 4,500 divided by 30, 450 divided by 3, 150 generations. That's it. That's why we're all so similar to one another. And the difference between this skin color and the skin color of many of you lovely people in this room is one letter. In fact, I have the broken copy. We know this is the SLC2 gene. It's on chromosome 16. We know what letter changed. I have the inability to produce melanin in my skin. Oh, one difference explains races? Nonsense. All right, there's so many things I just skipped over. Tons and tons of subjects. We're going to break in a minute, and we're going to do a question and answer session. And you get a time to stump the chump. You ask me anything you like. I don't promise I'm going to know the answer, but I'll try. But before we get there, I do want to tell you one more thing about Creation Magazine. I want to tell you that you can get it. Now, you can read our articles online. That's fine. You can do that if you like. But Creation Magazine has been profound in my own life. You saw the little Creation Magazines popping up in this talk? We're just trying to share you what it's done for me. Let me give you a couple more examples. Here's an article about carbon dating. And why I can say, thank you, Mr. Evolutionist, for inventing carbon dating. You've got nothing to say. It's mine. Go away. We own it. And I say that because this styrofoam cup, they say that this came out of oil. This came from oil that was pulled out of the ground. They say that oil is 300 million years old. There's carbon-14 in this plastic. It's carbon-14 in every form of carbon we know. Amber, dinosaur bones, diamonds. That means that none of those things could be millions of years old. Because carbon-14 breaks down too quickly. Ours. So they invented it. Now they got nothing to say about it. Or here's an article about climate change. You know the climate change debate? You know why this is such a big deal to the environmental modelers? It's because they can't explain the ice age. What? They got the Earth wobbling on its axis a little bit every 10,000 years or so, and it causes a teeny little bit change in sunlight, which causes a radical change in the climate. That's why they're afraid of climate change, because maybe a little bit of change in the heat load from the carbon dioxide you put in will create a radical change in the climate. But they're denying the single greatest episode of climate change in Earth history, Noah's flood, that triggered the ice age. Oh, go on creation.com, just type in ice age. Tons of information about it. Here's an article about the creative genius of God. And it talks about things changing and adapting. Because change and adaptation isn't evolution. Creationists are writing about that for 80 years or more before Darwin. Of course we believe things change. You ever see a chihuahua? You know what that is? That's a gray wolf. Look what we did to wolves. Things change, but there is a limit to the amount of change because any complex system, you can change and fiddle with it, but if you push it too far, you break it. And that's what we're seeing in biology. Things have the ability to adapt because our genius God put that into his creation. But you can't push it too far. So dogs can't turn into cats. But wolves can turn into coyotes. And by the way, they're actually the same species because they can still interbreed. That's another story. And every edition of Creation Magazine's got a kids section in the middle of it. Good stuff. We also have a digital version of our magazine, which is really neat because we don't have to physically print. How much it costs to print 40,000 Creation Magazines? That's a lot of money. Most publishers have advertising in their magazines, so the advertising pays for all the printing costs. We don't. But when we came out with the digital version, we realized there's no extra cost. Once we pay the artists and the authors and all that kind of stuff, we just send an email to someone. It's free after that. So what we do is we tell people, if you sign up for the digital version, we'll let you share it with 5 other people. We don't care who they are. We'll send you a little link in an email. It'll link to our webpage, to our website, and a picture of Creation Magazine will come up. You can even turn the pages. Really cool. It's there if you're interested. Now, it comes out 4 times a year, so we like to encourage people by giving them a free gift. I have some copies of the magazine back there. The copies are for you if you sign up for a 1-year subscription. If you sign up for a 3-year subscription, we'll give you a copy of the magazine and also your choice of 2 DVDs. You can get this talk, The Alternative Creation's Competitive Edge, or Darwin, The Voyage That Shook the World. This is our first documentary we ever made. It cost us a little more than $1 million. That's cheap for a documentary. And we did a good job on it. But also, for a 3-year, I will throw in an extra DVD, How Darwin Got It Wrong, 7 Major Points, and It Wasn't Just About Science. Now, the speaker here is a good friend of mine, Dr. John Sanford. He is a world-renowned genetic engineer. He was an evolutionary biologist at Cornell for 30 years. 20 years into it, he got saved. About 5 years before he retired, to the horror of his colleagues, he became a creationist. He's one of the smartest guys in the world, the Bible-believing scientist. Of course it can happen. The Holy Spirit does funny things to people, doesn't he? So that's, you can get that. Here's what our sign-up form looks like. All you have to do is put down your contact details again. You have to check off one of those boxes. This should be obvious. You know, 1 year, 3 years, digital or not. And then tear off that little corner piece and bring it to the back here and we'll take care of you. Okay, you can do that now. All right, I'm going to just give you a couple more books. That red book, the Creation Answers book, that's where you want to start. If you don't know where you are, what to do, you've never heard this stuff before, the red book is a great place to start because it's going to answer 99% of your questions. We wrote it specifically to answer that many questions. We have some packs of books back there. Here's a neat book, Christianity for Skeptics. Very useful. If you don't know skeptics, you're not talking to enough people. If people aren't calling you names, calling you idiot, saying bad things about you, they're everywhere in a society today. This book will help answer their questions. Here's a DVD of mine. As a geneticist, now you notice I didn't talk much about genetics because if I do, I can't stop. But I am claiming in this hour-long talk that there's evidence of Adam and Eve, Noah's flood, and the Tower of Babel in the human genome. And it's obvious an evolutionist discovered it. And I lay the evidence out. Here's another one. I'm trying to describe how the human genome works, but no one understands how it works because it's too complex. In fact, I compare it to a computer operating system, and I say the human genome is more complex than mankind can understand because it is a computer system that was designed by someone much smarter than people. That was fun. Here's a Revolutionary Achilles Heels book and DVD. Please avail yourself. This is really college-level material, but high school students can understand this, and anyone older than that, if you've got a scientific bent. This is designed to challenge people with professors because the professors are the challenge. So here's a bunch of professors who don't agree with those other professors, giving them a totally alternate viewpoint. Busting Myths is a book. Back. I only got one left. Because this morning so many people bought one. This is testimonies of 30 PhD scientists, most of whom were atheists, most of whom were evolutionists, and saying why they came to faith and then why they got rid of evolution. There's a lot of them in the world, all over the place. Here's a little book. Anyone wonder, how do we get our Bible? What is inspiration? This book answers all those sorts of questions. We've got kids' books like Exploring Geology with Mr. Hibb. Excellent material to answer young people's questions before they get hammered at home, or get hammered at school, I mean. And look, how many young people are in this audience? You have children and grandchildren, right? Now, I'm not insulting you. This is America. And we've got to reach out to them. Even if our children get mad at us, we got to talk to our grandchildren. Oh, was there? Okay. Okay. All right, so excuse me. But I wasn't surprised because most churches in America, everyone's got gray hair. Now, some of us might dye our hair, but you know, I obviously don't. But it's a problem that we can address. Intergenerational. All right, I'm going to end up with this. 1 Peter 3:15. But in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you. Reason, thought, defense, apology. That's a commandment. You know that? Amen. Oh, that stinks because that means we have to open our mouth. But do it with gentleness and respect. My friends, you should know this by now, but harsh and sarcastic facts shouted in anger don't point people toward the kingdom. But a gentle answer has often been used by God to knock someone over and they fall to their knees. How do I know that? That's what happened to me. I was a little punk. I thought I knew everything, and that lady who was trying to witness to me, I insulted her. Never did get to date her daughter, but that's another story. She could have knocked me in the nose and been absolutely justified. And yet she just stood there and took it. And her defense burned a hole in my heart. She wasn't a scientist. She was a regular old lady. I used to say old lady. I'm older than she is. When I was 19, I thought she was old. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this world that you have created for us. We rejoice in the beauty, the complexity, the wonderment of it all. But Lord, thank you for giving us the Bible. You gave us a history of this, so we're not left wondering where it came from and why it happened. You've also given us a guide to the future, so we can rest confidently in the promises that have been given to us about what will happen later. Lord, thank you for the Holy Spirit that not only convicts us of sin, we got enough of that, but also drives us into the Word and convicts us of the meaning of the words. So Lord, please bear with us. We know we're stubborn, and we know we're lazy, and we haven't studied as much as we should, and we should be further along than we are, Lord. And we know that there have been times when you've been calling us to open our mouth, and we were afraid, and we didn't say anything. And yet, Lord, you still love us for some reason. You don't throw us off into the gutter. You keep picking us up and cleaning us up. So, Lord, we ask that you bear with us a little longer. And Father, take this church and bless these people to be faithful witnesses of you and your kingdom in the dark community in which they live. Help them, Lord, to be a light upon a hill, because there are people right around here who are wanting and need to hear about you, and they haven't heard it yet. Lord, in the meantime, just bear with us a little longer. Help us along until we get to see those pearly gates and you on your throne. And we all say, amen.
Amen.
Okay. Sorry. My clock says, daylight savings time. Come on, computer. It is 5:15. It did daylight savings time. All right, cool. Let's do 16 minutes. I like nice round numbers. We will quit at 5:30, I promise, okay? I'll stay in the back until midnight if you want to ask me questions, but for the group, 16 minutes. We can get a lot of questions in, but I don't know every doctrinal position of this church. Now, that happens to be my favorite verse in the Bible up there, so it's really cool to see that. But I don't know what you believe on a range of subjects. I don't want to be tempted to preach, to contradict something that might be preached from up here. So if you ask me a question about, Bible translations or the role of men and women or end times theology or speaking in tongues, I'm like, hey, great, you come back next Sunday and you got some sermon material. Ask me a question about science. It's fair game. I don't promise I know the answer, but I'll try. What I'm going to do, though, is I'm going to try to direct you to a source of answers. A lot of this can be Creation Answers book or maybe an article on our website, because I can't possibly give you the entire answer. Because if I start talking, I don't stop. I go in a million different directions. All right? Please keep it short. Make sure it ends in a question mark. Please don't give me a story, a dream. You would not believe things that people have said to me over the last 10 years doing this. But it's fun. It's my favorite time of the evening just to answer questions. All right, who's brave? Who's got the first question? Sir?
Climate change. Is that because of fossil fuels, or is it for some other reason, or is it real or not real?
Climate change is a speculative scientific matter that is not settled. Once politics got involved, it was all over. Anytime politics gets mixed up with science, I just get angry because you're not going to get the right answer. And then money comes in. So I will tell you that the Romans conquered the Mediterranean world during what was called the Roman Warm Period. And the Roman Empire collapsed the year that the Rhine River froze over, and all the barbarians, that's my ancestors, all the barbarians crossed over and wiped out Roman Europe. But the Rhine doesn't freeze today. And 300 years after that, the Vikings were farming on Greenland in places you can't have farms today because it's too cold. And they were there for like 300 years. And 300 years after that, we had what's called the Little Ice Age. And 300 years later, we have today. Yeah, climate change. Of course, the climate changes. But it's really complex, and none of the computer models have worked out to reality yet. And because it's so complex, we can't quite model it. However, it might be true that if we cut down every tree in the world, it will affect our climate. Yeah, we will. It might be true that if we dump tons and tons and tons of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, that the planet will warm up. That might be true. I don't know if it's true. A scientist estimate that in the time of the dinosaurs, which was, in my mind, before the flood, carbon dioxide levels were much higher than today, and there was a lot more plant life and a lot more animal life. Because plants eat carbon dioxide. You double the carbon dioxide, they grow faster. And they don't need as much water, etc. So I can't tell you that climate change is not real. I can say that I don't know what the future holds. Because it's science. It's not settled. So as best I can do. Go to creation.com, type in climate change. We got several articles on it. Sir.
Thank you for your conversation. I also wanted to bring out or ask, what's your take on carbon dating on organic matter versus inorganic matter? And could you go more into empirical evidence for or step-by-step science that you can observe over and over again versus how they try to say that God, they can't prove God created the world empirically? So,
oh boy, I can talk on this. I can talk for hours. Okay, first, carbon dating. Back in the day, they used basically it was sort of like a Geiger counter. And they have a lead-lined box and stick a Geiger counter in it. It was a scintillation counter, and they put a sample in there and they'd measure the pings, and they say, okay, this is carbon-14 decaying, and they get the decay rate and they back calculate to see how much carbon-14 was in the sample, and they use that to figure out how old things were, and it worked really well from before 1945, because after we started exploding atomic bombs, that screwed up all the clocks. But before 1945, all the way through the historical era, you can take a sample and get a pretty good estimate of how old that thing is. Really cool. But then they invented the accelerator mass spectrometer. And now we can measure almost down to single atoms. And we don't need to wait for the thing to decay. We can just estimate how much is there because it's there. So you can measure carbon-13, carbon-12, and carbon-14 in a sample. It's amazing. And what they learned was that all the samples, the old carbon that they were using to zero out their machines, when they put it in the new machines, there's 80 times more carbon-14 than the machine can detect. So this, you know, back when you couldn't see it, it was up here. And that's been true for every single sample of old carbon. So people have taken, in Pennsylvania, there's a coal depository that has coals from all over the world and all different places in the fossil record. They've taken coals from there and carbon dated them. And throughout the entire fossil record from, the evolution would say these Eocene coals are 30 million years old and the Pennsylvanian coals are 300 million years old. They had the same amount of carbon-14. Diamonds had carbon-14. Natural gas is carbon-14. There's no carbon on Earth that has zero carbon-14. But if the entire Earth was carbon-14, it would disintegrate in less than a million years. So anything that has carbon-14 can't be millions of years old. Okay, and more carbon-14 or the other question?
The inorganic, the organic versus inorganic. Is there different things that they look for in organic matter versus inorganic matter when they're carbon dating material?
Inorganic carbon. Basically, organic means is carbon bonded to oxygen and hydrogen. So sugar, protein, those sort of things. Those are organic molecules. Inorganic molecules would be diamonds and natural gas. They never thought to actually carbon date those things. They assumed it would have zero carbon-14. We carbon dated them. In some cases, we had to lie. We collected a dinosaur bone called a buffalo, sent it to a carbon lab. They gave us a result. Thank you very much. And we have the reports. Now, not me specifically, but friends of mine and someone who has money has been funding a lot of carbon-14 research, unbeknownst to the evolutionists. Yeah, there's different things. And you got to be careful, There was a big debate a while back. Did syphilis come from the New World, or did Europeans bring the syphilis? And syphilis is a horrible disease. When you die of it, you can see the skeletons. His bones are riddled with holes. It's an awful disease, terrible. And well, they found some syphilitic skeletons in Portugal that were really old. They said, oh, let's carbon date these. And they turned out they were older than 1492. So everyone said, aha, syphilis came from the Europeans. It was horrible Europeans brought it to the Americas. And so the next group of scientists said, wait a minute. No. These people lived on a village right on the coast. They ate a lot of shellfish. There's less carbon-14 in the ocean than there is in the atmosphere. You have to adjust for the carbon level of their food, and when you do that, they're post-1492. So you, to give you an example, that's just an example. You can't just throw something in the machine and get a date back. It's not possible. You have to apply a historical model. Another example, they found King Richard III under a car park, under a parking lot in England. He was buried after he was the last of the Plantagenets. He was killed in battle, and they buried him in an abbey that was later on fell apart, and then they bulldozed it, and they put a parking lot there. Well, they found King Richard III, and when they carbon dated his bones, it was wrong. And they said, oh, wait, he was the king. He would have eaten a lot of meat, and meat is a different carbon footprint than the peas that everybody else is eating, and therefore we had to readjust it, and they readjusted it to make it fit. But that's science. And that's radiometric dating. It doesn't give you an independent number. All right, I don't even remember what the second one was. Let me ask another question, somebody else. We'll maybe get back to that. Sir.
Thank you. My name is Gustav. First of all, thank you for this presentation.
Welcome. Where are you from?
I'm from Cameroon.
Oh, cool.
Africa.
I know where Cameroon is.
Oh, thank you.
Just because I have to study genetics and I have to study human populations.
Ah.
And so I try to keep up with countries in the world and where people come from.
Oh, okay.
Anyway, go ahead.
That's fine.
Well, no American knows where Cameroon is. To me. So.
I have a couple of questions. Maybe my first question is this. In many educational systems, evolution is continued being taught as a science. And they have book, our kids, they are continuing to receive all those materials. And what can be done to bring some change in the educational system? Because they have, the problem is they still receiving this material as being taught as science. And talking to them of millions years of
right. So how do we fix
evolution?
How do we fix or influence the educational system?
Yes.
All right. I'm going to tell you something. You're not going to like the answer. It's up to the Holy Spirit. It's up to us in prayer and us to be dogmatic and fighting to get these issues. But the people who set up our school system were secularists. The people who set it up did it deliberately on purpose. It was the industrialists and the socialists and the Unitarians in the Northeast who developed our school system on purpose to pull the kids out of the family and give them a secular training. And so now we say, how do we get prayer back into schools? It was never in the school. It was tolerated because the culture wasn't ready for it. So, my kids are homeschooled. But because I think I can give them a better education, I used to be a teacher. I know I can give my kids a better education than what they were getting in the school that I taught at. But also because I want to give them a Christian education, Christian background. But that can change. Governments are bad. And our government, sorry, I don't want to talk about politics, but anyone following this election cycle is going to be mad. I don't care who you are, you're frustrated. Well, why? Because the soul of America is being reflected in our voting patterns right now. Anyway.
Yeah, I'm sorry. My second question maybe is related to that is the age of the Earth. Most of time, I don't know what you think about the theory about evolutionist way of creations, saying that, in fact, one day, the understanding of one day is maybe thousands of years. Yeah, so it is has been always also a problem.
Did you see when I had the 7 days of creation, the 6 days of creation up? I said, you know, at one point in time, I tried to say maybe each of the days of Genesis was really a long period of time. It's called the day-age theory. You know, to God, one day is like 1,000 years, 1,000 years is like a day. So maybe each of these days is really thousands of years long. But scripturally, we know what the definition of a word means depending on context. And it says evening and morning. Evening and morning. Evening and morning. Evening and morning. So it's self-defining throughout the whole thing. So if I told you this, ready? Back in my grandfather's day, it took 30 days on a steamship to travel to Cameroon if you only traveled during the day. I just used that word three different times in the same sentence, and we know exactly what each meaning meant because of the context in which it was used. And when we look at Genesis, context is clear. So I do understand that the age of the earth is intimidating, because I used to be very intimidated by it, and there's still some things I can't answer. And I know why people kind of shake or wilt or say, I can't believe that it has to be millions of years old, because it's intimidating, it's hard. But the text doesn't allow it. I'm not sure exactly what your question was. I'm trying to answer, but I think I'm going in circles.
Can we get some other questions, and then we'll come back to you?
Okay. I got 2 minutes. How old is the earth? I wrote an article. It's on the website now. It's called The Biblical Minimum and Maximum Age of the Earth. And my friend and I, we sat down and we tore the Bible apart, every single piece and verse that you have to put together to estimate the age of the earth. And we said, okay, we don't want to know how old it is. What's the worst case? How old could it be and how young could it be? Plus or minus 308 years. The question was, how old is the earth? Okay. Okay. So plus or minus 308 years is the biggest range we could make. So it's about 6,220 years plus or minus 308. Go to creation.com, type in age of the earth. All right.
Do you know what caused the dinosaurs to disappear?
I do not know what caused the dinosaurs to disappear. I have several hypotheses about what happened. First of all, the post-flood world is radically different than the pre-flood world. A lot of things have gone extinct. Trilobites are gone. Lots and lots of things. I mean, the mosasaurs are gone. So things that could not survive happily in this world have gone extinct. Second, though, all the large land animals that have ever lived, the largest land animals, are already dead. The biggest birds, the biggest elephants, the biggest bears, the biggest cats, because in order to get large, you wait longer to reproduce, which means you have a greater chance of dying before you have babies. So, and then ecologically, if you have to get large, you've got to eat a lot of food every day. So if you've got a famine or a dry spell or something, you're at a much greater risk of dying. So large species are already always at a greater risk of extinction. Elephants will probably go extinct. Mice never will. So what happened to dinosaurs? It might have simply been ecology. But plus, if you look at the world today is a desert. If you take all that coal in the fossil record and you say that was alive in the morning of Noah's flood, there'd be 10 times more food, more plant material on the earth than there is now, which means gigantic herbivores can't exist on the current world. So they might not be able to live. But there's a lot more on that. In fact, I think the Creation Answers book has a whole chapter on dinosaurs. Sir?
Race is the color.
Yes. This might be the last question. I can talk for 3 days on this. Okay. What about it? Where does color come from?
Yes.
Okay. We have discovered in genetics 5 or 6 major genes that influence skin color. It's not easy. It's really, really complicated. If you have a lot of the genes for light skin, you look like me. I used to have red hair. Oh, well. If you have a lot of the genes for dark skin, you're going to look like some of the other people in this audience with darker skin. So most people in the world...
The color, you say.
What?
You're saying it's not just the color.
It's the intensity. It's the amount.
Okay.
There's only one skin color. Brown. I have less brown. You have more brown. And some people have even more brown. But you know, black skin is not African. There are really dark people that live in India. And there's really dark people that live in Australia. And they don't have African roots. So, oh, the features. If you take away the color of people, you will be surprised. My wife and I were at a Japanese restaurant. We had it was our 8th anniversary or something like that. One of the neighbors held the kids, so we went and got some sushi. Man, we were like splurging. It was an anniversary date. It was awesome. And they put us in a little room and closed the curtain. It was really romantic and cool. And a waitress comes in and takes our order, takes our drinks and leaves. And my wife says, "Did you see that?" Of course, I'm a scientist. I notice everything. I said, "See what?" She goes, "Did you see the waitress?" I said, "Yeah." She goes, "She looked just like me." I know that you are German, Dutch, Irish, and English. And I know she's Japanese. And she goes, "Watch." So the waitress came back in, and my jaw hit the floor. They were twins. They had the same eye shape, the same nose, the same height, the same build, the same ponytail. Just hers was black and my wife's blonde. I couldn't believe it. I got pictures I've been collecting over time. I got a picture of an African woman. She's got scars on her face. I don't remember which tribe that is. But she's got these almond-shaped eyes, just like a Chinese person. The first time I went to China, I was shocked. Because there's people with big all-round eyes and people with super squinty eyes and everything in between. So we have stereotypical features. No, there's not. I know white people with big lips, right? One of my friends that I went to I spent 4 years at a summer camp. It was like 60% African American and some whites and some Hispanics and some Orientals thrown in too. And one of the guys, Derek, good friend of mine, he had a big lip, and black people teased him about it. But I've seen white people with big lips too. It's not, it's stereotypes. Not nearly. Okay, now here's something sad about African American history. The average African American is 30% European. Because people are people. Now some of that was slave masters being really bad people. But I was at a church in Gary, Indiana. There's lots of African Americans in Gary, Indiana. And it's an African American church, an African American pastor and his wife, and I'm staying over their house for the weekend, and the lady comes up to me on Saturday night. She goes, "You want to see a picture of my white great grandfather?" Can I be more uncomfortable? And so she shows me this picture, and it's a white guy sitting next to a really, really dark-skinned woman. She goes, "That's my great-grandmother." She says, "They lived in Tuskegee, Alabama." And she goes, they lived on the plantation that his grandfather owned." I said, "And that's his, wife?" She goes, "Yeah, they married. They had 9 kids." She goes, "I still own 100 acres of that plantation." All my stereotypes got exploded in a 5-minute conversation. That was back then. So even our today, our views of American history have been tailored. I don't say colored, that'd be not the right word in this context. But they've been modified because we were not really there. We're talking about the treatment of Native Americans. I mean, I live in the area where they kicked the Cherokees out of for the Trail of Tears. I live in the first gold discovery region in America. And yet, there's a lot of people there who have Cherokee ancestry, et cetera. I mean, just, all right.
That's it?
And it goes forever.
That's it?
That's it. All right.